Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome to our Open Door Encounter on this Sunday. Our guest preacher this morning, who's part of our team, is Daniel. And so I welcome Daniel as he brings us God's Word this morning. And of course, we welcome all of us who are gathered here this morning. So it's good to see you all. And I've just got back from a live in-person service, so that's why I'm kind of just dashed into the online service just now. So please forgive me. Just to mention a few things. Hopefully, you all receive the new church's newsletter, which goes out each week online. It's an email and. In there you'll find details of our annual meetings, which are all now set. However, I do want to say that I think we may have to reevaluate those annual meetings because it looks like things are changing again, and we may find ourselves in lockdown this coming week. So we'll just have to see how that plays out. Whether or not that will impact the church, as again, I do not know, but I think we've got a lot to work out in the coming week, and we await further guidance from the government and the Church of England. So hopefully not, but who knows? It seems to me that everything changes on an hourly basis, and the difficulty we have is keeping up with it all and all the changes. So. Yes, so that's just to put you all in the picture as to where we are at. But certainly we have planned now our annual meetings, and I can't actually tell you off the top of my head when they are because I haven't yet opened my email since I walked in the door. That sounds like I usually do. But not every time I walk in the door. They are opening up now. But the details are in the pew sheets. I would encourage you all to read them. If you've not signed up, I'll put the link in the chat. So please follow that link and sign up to receive our weekly newsletter. And so the annual meetings, which are going to be in person, will be Askham Bryan on the 5th of October at 8 p.m. Copmanthorpe the 12th of October at 7:30 p.m. and Bolton Percy with Colton on the 19th of October at 7:30. They will all be in the church buildings if we are permitted to do so. And obviously I'll keep everybody updated as best as I can as things move forward and develop. So that's the plan. And obviously we're looking to elect new members to the PCCs, the church wardens, two for each parish, and two deanery synod reps for each parish also. So anyway, let's just pause for a moment and spend some time individually communing with God before we start our worship. So our opening words of worship. God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
God is good.
This is your day, Lord.
And we shall praise you.
This is your day, Lord.
And we shall declare your name.
This is your day, Lord.
And we shall worship a risen Saviour and our King.
And so we sing to worship. Here I am to worship. Thank you, Father, for your presence with us this morning. We pray that as we worship together, as we join together to hear your word, to declare your praises, you would speak into our hearts and lives and show us your grace and love for each one of us. In Jesus' name, amen. Over to Geoff now for our time of saying sorry to God.
Dear Lord, we are in that place again, on our knees, laying our lives before you. Thank you that on the cross you cried, "It is finished." You have done it. Forgiveness is complete. We can live forever in your grace, forever in your love. So we ask now for your forgiveness for the wrongs that we have done and the things we have neglected to do. We ask for your forgiveness for the people we have hurt along the way and those who we have failed to love as you love. We ask for your forgiveness. We receive your forgiveness and resolve in our hearts that with your strength, we determine not to make these errors again. We receive your forgiveness and by the power of your Holy Spirit, we walk away from everything we know to be wrong and embrace everything we know about you. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are always and forever yours. Amen.
Amen. And may Almighty God forgive us our sins, cleanse us from all unrighteousness, and restore us to the fullness of your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. And now we have our reading from the Bible. And this week it's coming from the Message translation, Matthew chapter 20, beginning at the first verse. A story about workers.
This is the reading from Matthew, chapter 20. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire labourers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the labourers the usual daily wage, he sent them into his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace, and he said to them, "You also go to the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right." So they went. When he went out again about noon and about 3 o'clock, he did the same. And about 5 o'clock he went out and found others standing around. And he said to them, "Why are you standing here idle all day?" They said to him, "Because no one has hired us." He said to them, "You also go to the vineyard." When early evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, "Call the labourers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first." When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now when the first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, "These last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us, who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat." But he replied to one of them, "Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give this last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous?" So the last will be first, and the first will be last.
Thank you, Claire. That was actually from the NIV translation, so not the Message. And so we now sing our next song, reminding us, "This is Amazing Grace."
Of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. Set free. that you've done for me. Brings our chaos back into order. Who makes the orphan a son or daughter? The King of Glory, the King of Glory. Justice shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of Glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. The Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would let down your life.
Right, well, I don't think we have any children with us this morning, but just to let you know, well, there's Geoff, but I kind of want to brush you over that. This week, the children's sheets are actually mainly looking at our reading from Philippians, which we haven't had this morning, so that's perhaps not most helpful. So it's actually about making choices. And actually, I suppose in a way, our story about the workers also talks about making choices. And the ultimate conclusion of that reading is we all have to make a choice at some point in our lives. So I'll leave it there. If you want to colour a sheet in, please feel free to do so. And I'll look at them when we come back. But now over to... Daniel. Good morning, Daniel.
Good morning. Right. Well, can I say good morning to all? And it's a real privilege and a pleasure to share the word with you all today. As we saw, the Bible reading was on the laborers in the vineyard. And what I wanted to use from that was the concept of what happened when they got paid. And so I'm speaking to you around the topic, that's not fair. And if I put it in the context of Why this parable? Well, in chapter 19, there was a rich young man who came to Jesus, and he wanted to know about eternal life and how could he inherit it. So Jesus started about the commandments and things like that. And he said to Jesus, well, all that I've kept for my life, I've done all these good deeds. And then Jesus said to him, well, go and sell everything that you have and come and follow me. Well, that was a bit of a tall order. He had a lot of wealth, and he thought to himself, I love Jesus. I love what he's saying. I want to follow him, but I can't sell all that I have. And that led the disciples to wonder, who could be saved? Here's this young guy doing everything that Jesus had mentioned, but then because he didn't want to sell his wealth, give everything up, he couldn't be saved. So they wondered that. And Peter then thought to himself, well, Lord, we have been following you all our life. Well, not all our life, since we met you. What's the benefit in being a Christian to us? Which is interesting, because sometimes as Christians, we sometimes cross our mind, especially when we have difficult times. Why are we going through any difficult time? What's this about? Because I'm serving you, Lord. And his question was, we have forsaken all to follow you. What shall we have therefore? So what I thought Jesus was trying to do here is to show the divine nature against the human nature, the divine nature of God against the human nature. And if we look at the laborers and just look at the human nature for a few minutes, when the master of the vineyard came in early morning and chose some workers, I am sure the ones chosen was full of joy. They was happy that they would have a day's work rather than stand in the marketplace idle for the day. They probably felt quite ecstatic that they were being chosen, but that they were paid a full rate for the day. Some Bible translations actually said it was more than a full rate. It was virtually equivalent to a soldier's wage. Whichever way you want to look at it, it was a good rate. And so it was not like cheap labor. So they were happy. It would meet their immediate financial needs. And so they were happy with the rate as well. They were satisfied that they actually had something constructive to do for the day. They actually could work rather than stand idle by. And if anyone's been unemployed and have had to just stay at home or just, you know, wander around wondering when will you be employed, you would know the experience of the joy of being employed again. If you were employed for some years and then you said you didn't like the job and what happened, and something happens, you made redundant, and you realize staying home idle, not having an income, is a very painful experience. So you can understand the joy and the elation that they had when they got employed. The satisfaction that they could do something constructive rather than in fact, I was talking to someone just yesterday, and he said with the lockdown, it was really fantastic because he ran his own business, and he never had much time for the kids, even for home life. He was working all hours. For the first time during the lockdown, he was able to go cycling with his sons around York. He spent time with them because they were away from school. And he said for the first month, it was very exciting. By the second month, his sons were saying, "Dad, we're riding around the same place again. We're getting bored." And he said late in the second month, he started getting bored. He had done all the house jobs. He had done going out, and he just wanted to get back to work in his business. So you could see their satisfaction in work. And we must always remember that and be grateful when we get tired in our jobs or we find it's mundane and it becomes routine. Just think, what if I don't have this? No income, just lazing around. It might sound as fun for 2 weeks on a holiday, but I can assure you it's not going to be fun if it lasts month after month. Just like lockdown is no fun if months we are locked down, can't see loved ones, we can't meet people, you can't go for a meal if it gets to a serious lockdown. Things change. So be satisfied when you have things in life, and you sometimes don't appreciate it that much. When I was a child, one of the songs we sang in Sunday school, which I love, and I still love today, and I still remind people when they moan, it's about count your blessings. Count your blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what God has done. And sometimes maybe we need to get that childlike effect and count our blessings and realize the state we are in now is not as bad as it can be, even if we're going through difficult times. They also were full of gratitude because they had a wage to meet their immediate financial needs. And I think November could well be a very difficult and horrendous month for this country, because when this furlough scheme finishes in October, I am sure there will be a fair bit of redundancies coming up. And Christmas, we could well have a lockdown because of large gatherings over Christmas, family and churches. January could be a very bleak month. So all I'm saying is there can be, and there possibly will be, very difficult times ahead, but we should still stop, recap that we have health. You know, we have our loved ones still, or we have a job, whatever we have. And even if we face unemployment, we have to trust that God will find a way to provide for us, because we are told if God could feed the sparrows in the sky, how much more he would look after his children. Not that he cares any less for the sparrow in his sky, because they're all part of his creation. So we should be gratitude. They showed gratitude, and we should have gratitude. Have gratitude for the church. Sometimes people would say, "Oh, church again Sunday. Now we can't even meet in church." And I'm sure, well, except for a limited meeting, but I'm sure when it's opened up, people will appreciate coming to church more than they've ever done. Because these freedoms we take for granted, when things change, we realize how much we value it and value meeting people, value seeing loved ones, value just having freedom to go where you want. Then they had the security. The fact that they had work one day meant that there was a need for laborers in the vineyard. And if they did a good job, the owner of the vineyard would certainly be happy to have them again, because he's got fruits, he's got crops, or whatever it was that he need to have sorted so he could sell, so he could have a living. So he needed them as well as they need him. And sometimes owners of businesses should also remember that they need the workers as much as the workers need them. And that's why a partnership in business, a model of that where people share together when they're working in an organization, or if they're doing charity work, whatever it is, you share and work together, like how the laborers had to do in the vineyard. And they had the security that they might have future work to improve their financial stability. So it was not just money for one day, but it was possible of security for some time while the crop, the fruits lasted. But what happened? After all these aspects of human nature, joy, elation, satisfaction, gratitude, and security, such positive emotions and aspects of life, then from that high, they went to a low. Disappointment. They were disappointed. They were disappointed. They were being paid the same as the laborers who only worked for an hour. Now, the fact of the matter is, the owner kept his promise. When he took on the first batch of workers, he said, "I will pay you a fair daily rate," as the Bible reading indicated. So they got paid what they expected. But yet, they were disappointed, or you could say they were jealous that the workers who joined latest were paid the same. It was not their money, it was the owner's money. Surely he has the choice to decide who he pays what rates that agreed. And he agreed with the others he'd pay a rate. Of course, human nature would say, well, if they work 1 hour, then they should be paid the equivalent daily rate pro rata. and this is why this parable was very hard sometimes when people just read it, because you think, that's not fair. If I work harder, I should be paid more. If I'm more productive, I do a lot of work in productivity with companies, and if I am more productive, then I should be rewarded for my productive rate. And this is where we talk about the divine nature as well as the divine nature of God as well as the human nature, because sometimes the divine nature is different, and I'll tell you why. They felt it was an injustice. Again, we had the cry, that's not fair. But we have this cry a lot in work, when it comes to bonuses, when it comes to pay increase. Although it's confidential, we all know people talk to each other. And then people think, that's not fair. I work just as hard, and she's got double the pay increase or double the bonus, or he has. But it happens with children. When with my grandchildren, we have to make sure we buy similar equivalent things. And I'm sure it would happen with your children or grandchildren, where if you give one something that the other perceive is better, the cry, that's not fair, comes up. So it's a natural tendency to think a comparison, that's not fair. But worst of all, they then got angry with the landowner. Angry. Here is a guy who gave them a job, agreed a rate, paid them the agreed rate, and then instead of being grateful that they originally was, they suddenly changed from gratitude to anger. And we see this so much in the Bible. 1 minute someone's praising God because something's good happened, and the same person, and it's happened with prophets, it's happened with the apostles, the same person then say, why God? Why me? So that human nature of forgetting your blessings and remembering things that go wrong is again a human nature. But what we have to realize is, as the people should be happy, they should have been happy with the generosity of the landowner, that he paid all the same. How did the original first laborers not know that the people who came in last, they had to wait? So they were idle while the first ones were doing good work, good for their physical bodies, good for their health. Marion's been trying to encourage me to do gardening. So she's Googled that, how good gardening is for your health, for your heart, for losing weight. So what I'm saying is, they should be happy that they were gainfully employed, because think of those benefits of toiling in the soil. Also, they don't know the financial needs of the workers who've joined last. Maybe they were not as fit, maybe they were not as able, maybe they couldn't work a full day, but they had the needs. God looks at his children in different ways, and how he decides to reward them, that's God's decision. We should be grateful for the rewards he's given us, because the Bible tells us he meets each according to their needs. And we should remember that. Therefore, the landowner said to them, "Is your eyes evil? Because I am good." Evil eye is a Hebrew expression of envy or jealousy. As Christians, are we envious of Christians because of their talents or possessions or successes? It's interesting because this evil eye, even the Caribbean, and by the way, if you see my left eye red, it wasn't because Marion boxed me because I wasn't doing gardening. It's because in a rush to put on my swimming goggles, it flicked back and hit me in this right eye. I just thought I'd mention that because you might see it on the screen, on the left eye. But evil eye, we use in the Caribbean as an expression. People say, if someone say, your crops look lovely, the first thing someone says is, I hope you're not putting the evil eye on it. Meaning you're jealous how good it looks at. And sometimes envy and jealousy, this is a context of an evil eye. People use it in that context. But as Christians, are we envious or jealous because another Christian has different talents, or they're a good singer, or whatever they do, or they're talented in their job? As Christians, we should not be, or someone else has got a role in the church that we're not happy with. God gives his people roles and responsibilities, and we should be happy. Another Christian has a new car, rejoice for them. They've moved to a new house, rejoice for them. You know, we should not, that's a divine trait. We should be happy for our fellow Christians and anybody who achieve things, who have benefits. God in time will bless you with what your needs are. God will meet it. So remember, his generosity is to all. God is generous, but the important thing is, God is generous to his people, even if they served him 1 year or 100 years. And this is why Jesus said, the last shall be first and the first shall be last. What he was trying to tell his disciples, my blessings and you coming into the joys of the Lord, living in glory with me, doesn't depend on your length of service. This is why God has admonished us to go ye on to all the world and preach the gospel, because he wants more and more, just like the owner of the vineyard want more and more workers. God wants more and more people to come into his kingdom. And it doesn't matter if one does 100 years of labor or 1 month of labor. If you come into the kingdom of God, you will inherit the joys of the Lord. And we must remember that. The opportunity that God's given us to reach others, just like the owner of the vineyard took the opportunity to give people for 1 hour work and get paid. We must remember Matthew 28 and verse 19 says, "Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. This is for others to come into the fullness of life, which as Christians we enjoy." The next divine trait is equality. The first workers' attitude was similar to the Pharisees. They were incensed by Jesus' teaching that anyone could inherit the kingdom of God. They thought it was them alone. They despised Jesus for offering the kingdom to the poor, the oppressed, the weak, who he made equal to them. But Matthew 11:28 tells us, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I shall give you rest." So Jesus is saying, and this is why the Pharisees didn't like him. They wanted it protected. They alone could inherit the kingdom of God. But the divine commission is that all could inherit the kingdom of God. And that's why as Christians, we are admonished to be evangelical, to go out, not just to sit in our pews and think this is a good service. We are happy. We enjoy God. We need to share that message with others so they too could come into the kingdom. I want you to know the final point is inheritance. Material inheritance is sparse via wealth accumulation over a period of time. Whereas spiritual inheritance, as I've said before, does not come through a length of service or how hard you worked in the kingdom. The reward of eternal life will be the same for all. Eternal bliss in heaven in the presence of God. Luke 23:39-43 tells us, "The thief on the cross, whose life of service was limited to a moment of repentance and confession of faith in Christ, received the same reward of eternal life as Apostle Paul." Now, our human nature would say, that's not fair. But why is it not fair? Paul had the satisfaction of preaching the gospel, of advising churches, of seeing through his life, thousands, indeed now millions, have come to know God. That's something in you that a life of service has given him, that satisfaction. And when we serve God, we've had years of enjoyment. When I think of my Sunday school days, when I led youth group, when I pastored churches, when I taught in our Bible college in the Caribbean, all that length of experience has given me so much satisfaction. When I see others have come to God, that why would I want to just at the last minute of my life accept Christ and then say, "Oh, well, I did what I did, but I still get the inheritance." The satisfaction is your life through Christ and what it being achieved. But there are people who will come to Christ on their deathbed, who will come to Christ with only a few years of life. We have to rejoice with them because they have come into the kingdom. And indeed, if we believe in eternal life, we'll be sharing eternal life with them in glory. So that's why we rejoice when people come in. And finally, I'll finish by saying the laborers should be happy that all their friends in the marketplace had got a wage. We should be happy that all Christians are blessed through God and enjoy their life and seek through them and us to bring others to God. And finally, I would say a Christian reached the pearly gates. And St. Peter was manning the pearly gates. And he said, this is a story, by the way. It's not biblical, just a story. And he said to Peter, "How could I get in these pearly gates?" And Peter said, "You need 100 points. So the guy said, "Well, I worship in church, I attend the church regularly, I I paid my tithes and offering. And Peter said, that gets you 1 point. Then he said, I was a good husband. I was a good father. I was a good worker. He said, that gets you another point. So then the guy says, well, I don't think I could ever get into heaven unless by the grace of God. And Peter said to him, that's 98 points. Well done, enter into heaven. And the good news is that it's only by grace. We could only achieve this by grace we are saved. Ephesians 2, 8 and 9 said, for by grace are you saved, through faith, and not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, that any should boast. And then the good news is 2 Corinthians 12 and 9. We can be reassured that, as the Bible tells us, my grace is sufficient for you. So as I say, as we look at this parable, a lot of people look at this parable and say, that's not fair. But what the parable is telling us, it is fair, because we are not going to achieve life everlasting through our works, through our righteousness, but through grace. And that's why it's possible. And that's why God sent his son. And that's why Jesus died on his cross. So by the shedding of his blood, we can have remission of our sins and eternal life with him in heaven. That was the ultimate act of sacrifice. But that's the act of grace, to let us know his grace is sufficient to us, for us through good times, but also through difficult times. If we just bow our heads, I'll conclude the sermon with just a quick word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for giving us your word, that we could look into your word and a parable such like this of the laborers in the vineyard and get lessons that teach us about the material world in the life we live and how we behave in terms of appreciation, joy, gratitude. Let us learn to appreciate things in life and count our blessings, but also let us learn of your divine heavenly nature, that all things are given to you, our blessings are from you, and your grace is sufficient for us to be able to enjoy eternal life with you in glory. Thank you.
Thank you, Daniel. I'm sure, well, I've certainly learnt from that sermon, so thank you. I've been reminded of things I ought to know. Anyway, we move on to our prayers now, unless any of you have completed the children's sheets and want to share that with us. I don't think so. So we move on to our prayers. So let us pray. In the parable of the workers in the vineyard, the parable of the landowner hired labourers throughout the morning and the afternoon. And at the end of the day, he paid the same salary, regardless of whether they'd worked the whole day or just a single hour. As Daniel has shared with us, on first look at that, it seemed unfair, especially to those who'd worked the full day in the heat of the sun. But God, symbolised in the parable by the landowner, is happy to accept everyone into his kingdom at any time in their life. All that needs to happen is that they willingly turn to him for forgiveness. Each of us will receive God's chosen reward for us. It's never too late to come to God. whether you're just starting out in life or in the sunset rule years. So to begin with in our prayers, let's pause for a few moments and just think about those we know and those we love whom we would like to see come to know Jesus, and pray silently for God to give us opportunities to tell them about Jesus and what he has done in our lives and could do in theirs. You may like to, if you have some paper and a pen handy, write down the name of that person or persons, and just keep that in your Bible for when you're praying, and just to remember to pray for them on a daily basis. So just a piece of paper like that with a name on. If anyone's wondering what that name is, it's name. Lord Jesus, you open your heart to all sinners and invite them to follow your ways. Strengthen our resolve to accept your promises more fully and with greater urgency in our hearts. And so we pray for the struggles we're having in our own lives and in our world. And we pray for the continuing crisis of COVID-19. We pray against the potential resurgence of the virus, the second wave, another wave, and possibly more waves. But we pray against those, Lord. Protect your people, Lord. We pray for the medical and caring staff who are looking after patients, those who are who have continued to work throughout the pandemic and work hard. We just give thanks for them and for their sacrifice. So in a moment of silence, we just bring to mind those we know who have been working as doctors, nurses, and medical staff throughout the pandemic. We also pray for others who have been continuing to work throughout the pandemic in difficult situations. We pray for our teachers and school people who work in schools. We pray for their protection. Pray for people who have kept shops open and running. For the farmers, for everyone, Lord, who's continued to work throughout this pandemic, often putting themselves in susceptible positions. We also pray for those who are having to shield continuously at home. Give them courage and hope and perseverance. And we pray also, Lord, for our government, for our Prime Minister Boris, and all who are involved in leading the country's response to COVID-19. Give them wisdom and guidance, that they may know what is right to do. We also pray for those who are fearful about the future, especially for those who are alone or infirm, those facing the possibility of redundancy. All those who are returning to work, even perhaps with trepidation at what it might bring. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we pray for your church, Lord, throughout the world. And for the way in which we respond to this crisis, the way in which we support those in our communities who are struggling. Give us guidance and wisdom and direction. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we pray particularly for those who are struggling and continue to struggle with ill health that put them into a vulnerable position. For those who have been bereaved, not just those who have been bereaved through COVID, but also, Lord, those who have had to face the pain of bereavement with the sadness of not being able to say goodbye properly. We thank you, Father, that you are with us all. Be our comfort and our strength. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And all of us are facing difficult times. All of us are continuing to struggle with the difficulties that we face. But perhaps one of the most encouraging prayers at the moment is that prayer which brings us all together. The Lord's Prayer in its traditional form. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. And so we conclude our worship with singing the song Cornerstone. I'd invite you to grab a coffee afterwards and have a chat with those of us who are here, and so don't disappear quickly. I'm just going to end with I'm just going to say first of all that we'll continue with this online event at 10:30 each Sunday for the moment. I don't think we're in a place to think about moving this service into church. In fact, I'm beginning to think that we may have to go back to all online worship as if things develop as rapidly as they seem to be doing at the moment. But I will do my best to keep everybody informed of all that is happening and how we're going to move forward following the government guidance and the guidance issued by the Church of England. So watch this space, watch our Facebook pages. Obviously you can't watch this space because you're not going to be able to find me on Zoom all the time. But on our Facebook pages, websites, and emails. So please do pray, particularly for those who are having to make difficult decisions about what is going to happen. I'm hoping and praying myself that we will not have to go back into lockdown, and we need to trust God that he will be in whatever situation we find ourselves. So a final blessing for each one of us here today and all those whom we love and care for. May the God of love, the God of grace, draw us into his kingdom. Open our gates to welcome all to come and know him, and surround each one of us with your peace, Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you, remain with you, and all those whom you love, now and forevermore. Amen.